Okay, well, good morning and thank you all for joining us for the third in our series of coffee hour discussions to talk about issues of significant importance to the Great Lakes region. My name is Erica Jensen and I am the Executive Director of the Great Lakes Commission, and I'm pleased to be able to bring you these sessions as part of the Commission's annual Great Lakes Day events. The Great Lakes Commission is a binational agency established in 1955 to protect the Great Lakes and the economies and ecosystems they support. And we're comprised of appointed commissioners from each of the 8 Great Lakes states and 2 provinces. We are pleased to be able to provide a forum for Great Lakes stakeholders to gather and work together on efforts that strengthen the Great Lakes region and protect and restore the world's largest system of fresh surface water. Normally, we would be hosting our Great Lakes Day events in Washington, D.C. in person with all of you. And while that was unfortunately not possible again this year, we are excited to be working with several of our regional partners to put together these virtual events that highlight the importance of and excitement around Great Lakes issues. Throughout the week, you have been hearing from members of Congress, the Canadian Parliament, experts in maritime transportation, state natural resource leaders, and mayors on the front lines of coastal and climate resilience in the region. Before we move on to our topic for this morning, I want to briefly cover a few logistical items. Attendees will remain in listen-only mode throughout the event to minimize disruptions. This event is being recorded and will be made available at a later date. And if you're having technical difficulties, you can message the meeting host. And finally, if time allows, we may take 1 or 2 questions from our audience. So if you have a question for our panelists, you may submit it through the Q&A function on Zoom. And now for our session this morning, the Great Lakes region has long recognized the threat of invasive species to our ecosystems and economy. Mention the word sea lamprey or zebra mussels or invasive carp to residents of the Great Lakes, and you'll often get an immediate and a negative reaction. We know that harmful invasive species jeopardize our world-class fisheries that drive recreation, tourism, and commercial activity. And as a region, we've spent millions of dollars managing and working to eradicate species that have already been introduced. The good news is that we have success in addressing harmful invasive species. The better news is that there is also broad recognition that preventing the introduction is a more effective tool in protecting the Great Lakes ecosystem and economy. Invasive carp, including bighead, black, and silver carp, represent a group of species they're certainly at the forefront of our minds when we think about prevention. The Great Lakes states have worked together over many years to develop a suite of strategies to prevent their introduction of these species, including barriers and waterways, mutual aid exercises that mobilize experts from throughout the region, and more. Currently, a major focal point in our collective prevention effort is the Brandon Road Lock and Dam in Joliet, Illinois. And the Great Lakes Commission, at the request of the states of Illinois and Michigan, are convening the states and provinces in a forum to share information, develop strategies, and define regional roles in the effort to support Illinois, which is the non-federal sponsor for this important U.S. Army Corps of Engineers project. And so we're hosting this morning's discussion along with our partner, the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Governors and Premiers, an organization that supports the states and provinces' efforts to grow the Great Lakes regional economy. And it's my pleasure to introduce my colleague and their executive director, David Nafsker, to say an additional few words of welcome.
Thank you, Erica, and thank you to everyone for joining us this morning. This is a really important discussion, and as Erica noted, we can accomplish great things when we work together and where there's consensus. We've done that successfully on a number of different issues related to aquatic invasive species. And Brandon Road is the critically important next step. And here again, we've made tremendous progress in building consensus among partners to a shared action plan. In December, the 8 Great Lakes governors all joined together to sign a joint letter to Congress outlining their call for full federal funding for a barrier at Brandon Road. This is an important step as we work to build consensus in Congress with administration and others to get this project from an idea to reality. We've got the right people to talk about the issue this morning and a terrific moderator. I'm very pleased to introduce the director of the Department of Natural Resources, Preston Cole. Preston?
Good morning, everyone. And David, thank you. Erica, thank you. Wonderful opportunity for us to get together today to learn a little bit more, but keep some of the most dangerous circumstances in front of us. And so as many of you already know, you've seen the video of individuals who are in their boats and either spearing or, big head type of fish that are in our carp that are in our river systems. And it's on YouTube every place. Well, we need legions of people to do that if we're going to correct this invasive species issue, or we can use science, technology, and sheer grit to solve this problem. And so it's important for us to recognize that these fish at high densities can displace our native fish and alter the food web. And they spread very quickly throughout the Mississippi River Basin whenever they are unimpeded. So quite frankly, the Great Lakes provide the backbone for a multi-sector $6 trillion regional economy that includes, just to remind us where we are, a $7 billion commercial and sports fishing industry, a $15 billion recreational boating industry, and a treaty-granted tribal nations fisheries that could be severely compromised if invasive carp become established in the Great Lakes Basin. The Des Plaines River waterway system provides the Great Lakes and the St. Lawrence Seaway states and provinces with maritime transportation connections to the Illinois River ports, the Mississippi River ports, and the Gulf of Mexico. It has always provided the midsection of the nations and connections to the Great Lakes and the St. Lawrence Seaway ports and to the Atlantic Ocean, supporting well over $102 billion in annual wages. And that is nothing to sneeze at, folks. The Brandon Road Lock and Dam on the Des Plaines River provides a strategic focal point that can provide additional and enhanced controls as part of any comprehensive suite of measures to prevent big head, silver, and black carp from entering the Great Lakes Basin. Preventing the spread of invasive carp is a national problem, as shown by control efforts also underway in the Ohio River and the Upper Mississippi River Basin. Research and control actions on the Great Lakes can support and be relevant for efforts in other parts of this country. The Brandon Road Project will be a pilot for innovation and technologies that can deter the movement of invasive fish, benefiting other states, regions who can employ these technologies. So what we would be doing is ensuring that this new technology can be replicated in other places, in other parts, not only in this country, but the world. And so joining me today for a captivating discussion on the Brandon Road projects are the Illinois director, Colleen Callahan, shout out to Colleen, and also Dan Eichinger. And Dan and I, both of Michiganders, are on the call. We don't see each other as often as we should. So Dan, welcome. And we appreciate you taking time out of your busy schedule to be with us here today. So let me ask Colleen to tell folks a little bit about yourself and then followed up by Dan.
I am not a Michigander, as I said, but you cannot hear because I hadn't taken myself off mute yet. I am an Illinoisan or an Illini. My background, just very quickly, has not been the same as yours or Dan's. Mostly growing up on a farm, living on a farm still today, having spent most of my career in communications. The nexus between conservation, natural resources, and agriculture, I think, has oftentimes been overlooked. And so I'm encouraged by what we've been able to do together in this short amount of time since Dan and I have been working collaboratively regarding Brandon Road, along with the Army Corps of Engineers and certainly our staffs who are involved on a daily basis. So I'm looking forward to this conversation and to sharing what we've learned and to learning what others may have in questions that we might be able to answer. And if we can't answer them, we probably know the people that do have those answers. So Dan?
Thank you, Director Callahan and Secretary Cole. It's good to be with you both this morning, and to everyone who's on the coffee hour with us today. It's kind of good to be home and good to be back doing Great Lakes Day activities again. I was had a chance to scroll through the attendee list, and I've attended Great Lakes Day many, many times over the course of my career. So it was nice to see a lot of friends gathered here today for a project that has carried a lot of our sort of work thematically over the many years that we've been doing Great Lakes Day. You know, this is a conversation. We don't have to sell anybody on the need, you know, the need for us to do something to keep invasive carp from moving into the Great Lakes. You all have been the vanguard of carrying that message forward to our communities, developing stakeholder networks, leading the charge on advocacy, working with members of Congress. So this is going to be a good opportunity, I think, for us just to kind of give everyone a sense of kind of where we see the state of play today. I hope and expect that we'll be able to articulate some steps coming out of this that we can all commit ourselves to over the next few months. We've got an opportunity, I think. There's been a tremendous amount of work that has that's been undertaken already on Brandon Road, and Colleen and I and our staffs have been working very, very closely together on that. But truly, this is, you know, this is a regional problem, and it's a regional challenge. And we're grateful for both the council and for Erica and her team at the GLC for providing a forum and an opportunity for us to keep everybody in the region who is equally committed to this project up to speed and involved in the discussion. So it's good morning, and it's good to be with everybody, and looking forward to the discussion.
Awesome, thank you. And I think it's important for us to talk a little bit about why this is important. And with world affairs being top of mind, you know, $5 and $6 gasoline and the impacts that are going on in our own economy in the United States, I'd like for Dan and Colleen to talk a little bit about the why this is important, but also we should be providing enough talking points for folks on this call so they too can be on offense when we are in legislative committees or in front of groups and those types of things. And so, Colleen, can you talk a little bit about the why and provide some of the folks that are on this call some talking points as to why it's important?
Absolutely. You really set the stage for that, Preston. Earlier, you were talking about the impact on the economy, the entire Great Lakes system, when you were talking about trillions, and then you transitioned into the impact of billions. I'm going to add another one of those illions, and that's quadrillion, because the Great Lakes holds 6 quadrillion gallons of fresh water. Why is this important? It's because of that very thing. It is more than a fifth of all the surface fresh water on Earth. Fresh water. 40 million people in the United States and Canada rely on that source, that resource for drinking water. So it's important for all of those reasons. And then it's important because, as you also stated earlier, Preston, it is about the health of the ecosystem. When we start talking about the invasives, whether it's the mussels or certainly in this case, it's the invasive carp, as the Brandon Road Projects is trying to prevent from getting into the Great Lakes, it means that it puts the whole Great Lakes system at risk for humans and for the entire ecosystem. When we think about, as Dan alluded to, how long this conversation has been taking place, we are today able now to talk about an actual project in process. It's been conversation before, and now it's actually taking place. The preparation, the charrettes that have been taking place, which means that the Army Corps of Engineers, the Departments of Natural Resources that are involved with the state of Michigan and Illinois, and our Office of Water Resources personnel, the navigation industry, meeting on a regular basis to begin to actually design the barriers and I say barriers because they are plural. We hear about the electric barrier, the one that already exists at Romeoville in Illinois, and now a flushing lock system, acoustics, bubblers, in addition to an electric barrier. So these are all things that we should be proud of at this juncture, that we have progressed to this point. Now, it's not built yet. It's not fully funded yet. There are still a lot of things that we have to do to get done to see this to its fruition. But that's why it's important. That's why it's significant, because it is human life and it is the ecosystem that is depending upon us to get this done.
Thank you for that. Well said. Dan?
Yeah, I think, you know, we all understand that this is a globally significant ecosystem. The Great Lakes are a globally significant ecosystem. And as Secretary Cole alluded to in his opening comments, this is a globally significant region for the economy, for the global economy. And so protecting what defines this region, that facilitates public outdoor recreation, that fulfills our public trust obligations, that continues to support the development of robust Great Lakes-based economies and commercial activity, are critically important for our region, and they're critically important for the world. And, you know, why do we keep pursuing the end that we are? You know, I had a chance, I think it was 18 months or so ago, we had a little event with the Army Corps of Engineers, and Colleen was there, and we kind of talked about sort of kicking off our work and kicking off the project that we've been engaged in for the last couple of years. And I described it at that time as being not the end of the trail, but the end of the search for the trailhead. We're on a path now, and what we need to do is to continue to ensure and build pressure and build inertia behind completing that work. As Colleen talked about, you know, we have a plan that's been identified. We're working through the complexities, none of which are lost on any of the people here gathered around a coffee hour. I mean, these are incredibly complex projects. They are incredibly expensive, and we cannot, but because we're on this path now, because we've found the trailhead and we're walking down that path, this is not the time for us to get weak-kneed. This is not the time for us to assume that this is self-evident, that completion is self-evident. It continues to demand our attention. It continues to demand our energy. We're getting closer, but we need to keep the heat on and make sure that we're making the case, not just within the region. I mean, everybody here has done an excellent job of, you know, all of our citizens in our respective states and provinces understand the importance of the barrier for invasive carp. You have also done a tremendous amount of work over the last couple of years, I think, of nationalizing that problem and really creating a national character to this work. And we've got to double down and lean in harder onto that point so that we can continue to fill out what our funding needs are that are going to facilitate completion of the project.
Preston, let me add something quickly. And thank you, Dan, so well articulated. This is about our future. We have to acknowledge our past as well. And the Great Lakes system, of course, has been foundational to the history of this region, agriculturally and industrially. When we think about how we got to where we are, when we look at the economy and how it was based during the time that we were an agrarian society and then progressed to a more advanced industrial one, we've depended on it. And sometimes we've taken it for granted, it appears. And so that's our past, that's our history. But the future is what we are here today to determine together. And Preston, before we went live, you were talking about why this is important. And there are opportunities here for the obvious ones, but also for the ones that maybe we don't think of that are all combined here. And I would ask if you would share at this juncture why you think this is important. You've asked Dan and I that. What's another underlying reason why this has such great significance?
Well, as we talked earlier, and so for the folks that are on the call, you know, we are at level 5 of level 6 or 7 type of situations around this particular issue. And what Colleen and Dan are sharing with you is this is a call to action. You know, the time for engagement with communities around the Great Lakes it's imperative that our natural resource managers and our legislative bodies begin to draft rules and put things in place so that we can stop this unenviable creature from getting into our waters. And in having that conversation earlier today, we need every hand on deck. And I wonder if in our own communities, there are people who are unaware of the what's coming at us as it relates to this invasive species. And so while we want to make sure that every city, town, and village, and those people that we talk about that call the Great Lakes their home, we have to make sure that everyone is aware. You know, our communities of color need to be brought to the table and have that intimate conversation, not only about the idea of preserving and protecting this resource, but the jobs that are out there, whether it's commercial fishing, whether it's working as, you know, scientist-based, research-based, or colleges and universities. We have to pivot everything that we have in this region and everyone that we have in this region to create the strength among communities. And folks, that's every community. So what a wonderful opportunity to engage communities of color and enlist their support, their help, and get their adoration for being asked to the table to begin to convene these meetings, but also seek real life input in terms of jobs and educational opportunities around these. And so this is our call to action, folks. If you're on the call today, you cannot go back to normalcy as it relates to the Great Lakes region and what's before us. And so I certainly thank my two colleagues for, you know, raising these particular issues, because it's too doggone important for us not to. And as we move on, let's talk a little bit about how Illinois, Michigan, Wisconsin, how are we working together on this project to preserve what we have in our region? And Dan, let's start with you.
Thank you. I think probably the best way for me to describe how, you know, those of us in our respective natural resources agencies are trying to collaborate is that we're trying to be worthy of the collaboration that we have seen unfold throughout the region among our stakeholder community, our advocacy community, all of you. For the last 20 years of my career, you know, whether, you know, we have, you know, stakeholder interests in Wisconsin and Minnesota and Ohio and the province of Ontario, I mean, all across the region, those of us, when I was one of you at a time earlier in my career, you collaborated and we worked across jurisdictional boundary. We worked across interest area to collaborate, to make the case, to advocate in Congress and in our state legislatures and with our respective administrations. And I think thematically what we're trying to do within the architecture of our respective state governments is sort of be worthy of the collaboration that you've all demonstrated for the last 20 years or so. This isn't going to work if this is a problem that everyone says, well, this is just Illinois' thing to figure out now. And let Colleen and her staff, you know, work through, you know, the difficulty of trying to develop a project, fund a project, which I know we're going to talk about a little bit later. We're all here because we all have an interest in this collectively. And so it was extremely important for us in the state of Michigan to demonstrate to the state of Illinois and to everyone else in the region how seriously we view this issue. And I'm very pleased that, you know, Colleen and Governor Pritzker and the team in Illinois have been so accommodating and so willing to have us in the state of Michigan, the Department of Natural Resources, quite literally at the table with them for every discussion that they have with the Army Corps of Engineers. We participate in our quarterly update meetings. We are a full partner to the state of Illinois. And I think, you know, what that enables us to do is to help support our colleagues in the state of Illinois. It gives us the opportunity then to be able to communicate back out to the rest of, you know, to the rest of the basin and the rest of the region on status of project. But it truly, you know, we really want to be worthy of the level of partnership and commitment that we've seen exhibited by all of our stakeholders and partners and advocates and friends that are also interested in this issue, and be able to demonstrate that in a real and meaningful way with the commitment of our time, talent, and resources to help support the state of Illinois, the Army Corps of Engineers, and all of us in this goal.
Preston, I would like to thank Dan for so well stating how we have worked together. And to add to that, while Illinois is the named non-federal sponsor, that comes with not only an expectation of so many different things, but as Dan said, we'll talk about funding in more detail in just a little bit. It does always, it seems, no matter what, it always gets down to the money. But before that, Dan would probably be alarmed if I didn't talk about the three C's that are foundational to me, and that is communicate, collaborate, and connect. And clearly we have been doing that, and it has been effective. We have been communicating across all lines. Now, it's unusual for the Army Corps of Engineers, when they have a non-federal sponsor partner, to say, oh, okay, well, let's bring somebody else in. That doesn't typically happen. That's happening this time. So there is that communication component, clearly collaboration. And what we're doing now, right now, at this very moment, is that other C, that's connecting, so that we can share what the current status is, what some of the complications another C still is. And I think there's another one, and that is compromise. Sometimes that's not a term that is commonly used in working on a project like this, certainly of this size. And so to answer your question, Preston, about how we've been working together, on Christmas Eve in 2019, I was at FedEx with documents that I had just signed, sending them to the Army Corps of Engineers in the Rock Island District and to Dan in Michigan so that they could sign them so that we could move forward with the PED, the preliminary engineering design. So we have not taken this lightly, and we have not said, well, this can wait, because we know it can't. And so it's just an exclamation point as an example as to how we have been working together. Beyond the financing, Dan in Michigan and his governor stepped up and said, we want to help and we want to help fund. And so it has been a partnership and a collaboration that is very unique, particularly, as I said, for a project like Brandon Road.
Well, thank you. See, for the folks who are listening, you know, this notion of ideas about how we should go about doing our business. And I just want to remind us that what Colleen has put on the table is just a path, a roadmap to ensure that these types of projects get taken care of, the funding comes, we have our stakeholder groups and meetings, and of course, all of this surrounded by just drama and financing and the like. But what Colleen is saying is that this too shall pass if and only if we communicate, we collaborate, and we connect. And lastly, when it gets dicey, we compromise and we link hands. And so your takeaway today, folks, today is just to remind us on some of the most traumatic things that are before us as a community of Great Lakes professionals, that it only happens when we follow these four C's. And mark your calendar, because Colleen went from three C's to four C's, and that's worthy of our attention, if nothing else. So thank you for that, Colleen. And again, if the Senator Stabenow was here, Colleen and Dan, what would she be talking about in terms of the federal government's role to provide assistance to the states keeping this carp out of the Great Lakes? What would she be saying right now if she was here? Colleen?
Oh, I thought you were going to throw it to Dan. Let me preface that by saying that Also in 2019, prior to the Christmas Eve exchange of signatures, almost the entire, there may have been one or two missing, but in almost the entirety, the congressional delegation of Michigan arrived at Brandon Road in mass, sitting down with the state of Illinois and with the Army Corps of Engineers to be on site and to see firsthand what Brandon Road looked like, what the project at that time may include. And so I certainly can't speak for the senator, but I did speak with her that day. And what she would say is, and certainly Dan can jump in here too, is that this is our responsibility. This is up to us now to make certain that we work together to build Brandon Road for the reasons we've all talked about here and have lived for a long time. And not only is that entire congressional delegation committed to this, but just a few weeks ago, it's rare to have two of your United States senators in the same place at the same time in the state that they represent. But just a few weeks ago, both Senator Durbin and Senator Duckworth were at Brandon Road, along with the state of Illinois and the Army Corps of Engineers. And so when you ask what the federal government would say, they would say, we need to do this and we need to be partners. And now that we've kind of stepped into the funding piece, 100% federal funding is a big part of that conversation. It didn't start out there, but Dan was able to really jumpstart that conversation. And I'd like for Dan to pick it up from there.
Sure, thanks, Colleen. Yeah, I mean, I think if Senator Stabenow were here, and I know she's participated in Great Lakes events throughout the duration of her time in Congress and in the U.S. Senate. And, you know, we've got a lot of great friends in Congress that are champions for the Great Lakes. And I'm very proud to say that that the senior senator from the state of Michigan is a champion among champions for Great Lakes. She has authored so many critical and landmark pieces of legislation that have benefited our work. And I think as Colleen is alluding to, you know, not that long ago, we did something I think that's pretty remarkable, and we got most of the governors from the Great Lakes of the Great Lakes states and regionally to ask Congress for full federal funding for the Brandon Road project. And I think the reasons, again, for that are fairly self-evident. I mean, everyone here understands the global significance of this resource, the global significance of the economy upon which is dependent upon that resource, that these are not, you know, preventing invasive carp from moving into the Great Lakes is not a problem for the state of Illinois to solve on its own. It's not a problem that just within the Great Lakes region that we can probably solve on our own. This truly has to be a national response. This is a national threat. And when you have a threat of that category, I think it's appropriate, and I think Senator Stabenow would agree, as many of our governors have agreed, that that requires the full support from the federal government to solve it. And again, I think the, you know, where we are with you know, the status of the Brandon Road project, where we are in the PED phase, what we anticipate getting ready to do when we get to construction, we are now committed. We cannot fail at this point. Failure is not an option now. We have got to land this plane on the runway. And so I think it would be an absolute travesty and a shame in the true sense of that word if we let money be the reason we could not get this very, very important work done that we have all strived for so hard for the last couple of decades. I think that's a winning argument in Congress. And again, I'm going to take another minute and thank everybody here. You all have been carrying that message for years. You have been carrying that message to Congress. You've worked within your respective states and provinces. So please know that you have my eternal gratitude for your constant leadership on this issue And I know that with your support and with your fervent advocacy, we're going to be successful in this most critical part of the project, making sure that we've got the funding aligned to get the project done. Full federal funding, I'll also say, just sort of on the wonky side of things, it obviates a lot of, you know, it obviates a lot of challenges that we will have to work through and that we will work through. But with full federal funding, it obviates a lot of those challenges, and it's truly the shortest distance between the two points. And I think that's the thing that we need to really keep in front of our headlights, is that if we want to get this project done truly as quickly as possible, full federal funding is that shortest distance between those two points. And we've waited long enough, and it's time for us to get it done.
Yeah, and let me add some specific numbers to that too, Preston, if you would. The project now is close to $1 billion to expected once it's completed. Again, that changes daily. So 800 and some million dollars, nigh on to $1 billion. Where we are in this preliminary engineering design, the PED phase, where Illinois and Michigan have been working together to fund that piece of it. When it was recently announced that the federal government was receiving funds from the infrastructure bill, the $225 million, that is a game changer to a degree. It just changes the game. It doesn't finish the game. This is March Madness. So it's like all of a sudden, the refs came in with a new reg that wasn't on the floor before. So what that means is that the Army Corps, with this new funding for the build out, that's money for the construction. That's not money for the preliminary engineering and design. So there has to be a project partnership agreement in place. And so where we are now is the discussion of ratcheting up the timeline. And for months, there have been requests, can you hurry up? Can you speed this up? How quickly can we get this done? Because we all agree that time is of the essence. So there's no argument on doing this as quickly, but as well and procedurally as needs to be done. But what that means potentially for the state of Illinois, we've talked about the fact that Brandon Road is the pinch point. So yes, it's in Illinois. Yes, we are the non-federal sponsor, but nor would any state be in a position to, at the next phase, by a certain point, be able to potentially come up with another $200 million. And then with the requirement of maintaining that in perpetuity is something that the state of Illinois will likely never have the financial capability of doing, nor would any state. Yet because all of us have such a great stake in this, Dan is right. The full federal funding is what not only makes sense, but actually what's needed in order for us to get to where we need to be as quickly as we need to get there.
Awesome. Thank you for that. And
Dan, would you add or subtract from that?
Well, no, that was perfect.
Yeah, I would say that it needs no addition. And I'll just remind the folks on the call is that, you know, our senators, our federal senators need to hear from you if you haven't already, because they got our back. And having our back means that, you know, a short handwritten note or a call to their office and say thank you for the work that they do goes a long, long way. It means that we are paying attention to the work that they're doing on our behalf. Those threats to the Great Lakes are going to be robust, and they'll come often. You know, raise your hand if you remember when a then governor of Arizona wanted to put a pipeline from Arizona to the Great Lakes. These threats will continue. Whether they be two-legged or whether they be invasive or not, we need to remind thank our federal partners about the importance of having our back in the Great Lakes region. So we have two professionals on that's leading us charge on this, and make sure you reach out to Colleen and Dan and continue to thank them for the work that they do. It's a day-long, lifelong effort that they're putting in play. And for that, we're indebted to you and for that type of work. Let's spend a bit of time to talk about the opportunities that exist within the WERDA and the SHORE Act. Dan, can you add some value to that conversation and educate folks on the call what that ultimately means for us?
Well, everybody here knows that, this is a WERDA year. We do WERDAs every couple of years or every other year, I think. So this is a WERDA year, and that would be the place for us to park the authorization for the full federal funding. And that's, that's what our governors have tried to communicate to the Congress. And I think that's an opportunity for us to again, articulate the need, and the window is open, and now it's time for us to jump through the window. So, the folks gathered here know WERDA probably far better than I do, but that's, this is a moment where every other year we get a chance to authorize new money, and then we got to work on the appropriations process and all that kind of thing. But this is the time, and this is the year to do it. And the window's open, and that's what we're trying, that's what we've been trying to get ready for. I think we are ready for it. And now we just got to do the advocacy work and make sure that it gets in there and it sticks, and we can get that bill to the president's desk with full federal funding for Brandon Road.
Colleen, anything to add?
Ditto.
Got it. I love that. Ditto. Perfect. And so what's the outlook for the timeline, Dan? Can you share a little light for folks on the call of this process? What are you thinking in terms of when and how?
Action on WERDA will probably happen later in the calendar year. I think typically that's a bill that moves in, late November, December, in these off years. Obviously it's an even numbered year. So, that always changes the equation, but, lame duck bill passage is, where a lot of gravy gets made. So, I think that's most likely that's going to be the opportunity. As everybody's certainly aware, Congress isn't passing a lot of legislation these days. This, I think, everybody recognized would kind of be elevated to the category of must pass legislation. So that's probably the timeline if I had to, kind of look in my crystal ball. But, again, I think, a lot of the folks, a lot of folks gathered with us today, know WERDA and they know how to work it. And I think that's what we can expect is, probably not towards the end of the calendar year where we see that piece of legislation move. But so that gives us a little bit of time to have good conversations with members of Congress and make sure that we've got, we've run all of their questions to ground and that we're being responsive to what they need. And that, we also remain flexible so that we can read and react to how, things evolve and change, over the next, 8 months or so.
Got it. And, one last question before we ask Erica to give us any questions that come from our participants today. And so this idea of national importance. So when you look across the United States, there are a number of ailments that we have as a nation. How do we tell the story about the Great Lakes region and the national significance of this work that we're doing on Brandon Road and what it ultimately means when people are competing for attention and funding all across America? Colleen, can you put a little thumbprint on what this national significance means for us and how it should resonate across the country?
Thank you, Preston. And I'll even add to your question there, reading in the chat here, even though the general rule is that Congress approves a WERDA bill every other year, that doesn't always happen. What is the backup plan in the event that WERDA does not move this year? Aren't there concerns with respect to the PPA, the Project Partnership Agreement for Illinois, if there is no decision on full federal funding? Yes, exclamation points. There is great concern. As I pointed out, coming up with $200 million soon is not something that's in our budget. It's not something that can quickly be legislatively approved. So yes, there are great concerns, which is what I know Dan has been saying, what Preston has been saying. We have to get this done. We have to do what we can do together to seek the full federal funding. none of us want this to be put on pause. Is there risk of that? Potentially. Potentially, yes. And that's not what anyone on this call wants. It's not what anyone who knows the Great Lakes, and even if you don't know the impact the Great Lakes has, it wouldn't take you long to realize that if we don't get this done, what the consequences will be.
Thank you for that. Dan?
Yeah, I think on, you know, sort of the national, you know, flavor that we can put over this issue, and we've talked about that a couple of times already, and I think what we all recognize is that we want to nationalize the story before we nationalize the problem. You know, invasive carp are on the move, and, you know, they're moving in, you know, the Ohio River watershed. We've got problem areas in Kentucky. We've got, you know, potentially problem areas eventually in Tennessee. I mean, they're, you know, this is a problem that is now starting to, you know, expand beyond the Mississippi River Basin and be a problem that's only unique to the Mississippi River and some of the tribs in Illinois. That, you know, that certainly assists our outreach efforts on the one hand, because it allows us to, you know, have conversations with folks in Kentucky about, hey, we got to do something about invasive carp. But that's, you know, but I think our hope is, and I got to give National Wildlife Federation some credit here for really recognizing that early on a couple of years ago and working to try to build out that narrative for other, you know, the next stop for invasive carp will be Kentucky. The next stop will be Tennessee. The next stop will be here and there. And they've really tried, I think, to start to tell that story in those places and build communities around around advocating for work on invasive carp. And that becomes, you know, as we've all recognized, I mean, there's a palpable sense of urgency here. We have tremendous opportunity in front of us, but we have to be equal to that moment, and we, you know, we can't pass it by. So again, sort of really doubling down on the global, you know, the global significance of the natural resource that we have here and the global significance of the economy and commercial activity that are based upon that natural resource is a winning argument any time in Congress, any time in a state legislature. And that's what I think we really need to be leaning into and continue to carry that message forward.
Well said, brother. Well said.
Preston, just one final thing, as I thank Erica and David for this opportunity to share what we've been able to today. This is, and I don't think we've touched on this, it's really a systematic approach. The Brandon Road Initiative is a combination of barriers to prevent the Asian carp from getting into the Great Lakes. But as Dan said, responsibility among all of us, and Preston, you and I talked about our commercial fishermen who are helping us every day by harvesting those invasive carp. Soon, there will be a rebranding launch for the invasive species with a new name, because it is a mild tasting fish. It does have application and promise for a new source of protein. So when we talk about a barrier, that's great, and we need that clearly. A barrier, along with all of the other things that we've been doing and need to continue to do, is what will give us the greatest chance for success of keeping the invasive carp out of the Great Lakes. All of us working together.
Now, the systems approach that you talk about is well stated, and that's certainly has to be one of the takeaways in terms of the folks that are on this call. Erica, our conductor, can you share any questions in the chat that you may want us to address?
Well, Director Callahan already picked up on one, and actually I have to say that we are at our time for this morning. So I would, before I close up, I just wanted to offer all of you one more chance to say any closing remarks before we wrap it up for this morning.
Ladies first, let's start with Colleen.
Thank you. Simply my thanks. This is absolutely down the wheelhouse of the three C's: communicate, collaborate, and connect. We've done all of those this morning, and soon we will be employing that fourth C, which is compromise. Thank you for this invitation.
Dan?
Just the same, just to say thanks, certainly to Erica and Dave for pulling the forum together, and thanks to all the advocates and friends and partners that that have joined us here this morning. You all are tremendous. You're an inspiration, and I think I can speak for Secretary Cole and Director Callahan. We are so pleased to be working alongside of all of you because you are all tremendous and talented, and I wouldn't want to be in this fight with anyone else. So we appreciate all of you for your consistent and steady work on this issue.
And I would only add that David and Erica in their role continue to have these types of thoughtful conversations across the United States as it relates to, well, the Great Lakes, relative to things that are threats to the Great Lakes and the Great Lakes region, everything that we stand for. And so for Colleen and Dan, just wanted to remind you that when you turn around, you will see throngs of people supporting you each and every day in the work that you do. And my responsibility to tell you, you are not alone in this fight. We stand with you. We love that the work that you're doing. Call us if you need us. If we can be of any assistance to folks on this call, thank you for your energy and your effort and your wisdom on this. And with that, I'll turn it back over to Erica.
Well, thank you very much, all three of you. This has been a truly inspiring discussion despite the sort of tough topic that we had in front of us this morning. So thank you all. You know, I will continue to emphasize collaboration, partnership, and look forward at the Great Lakes Commission continuing to work with all of you through the States and Provinces Forum in partnership with the federal government and all of our partners across the Great Lakes region to move this project forward and solve this issue. So thank you all, and thanks to all of our attendees this morning.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone. Take care.